So you are going as a branch auditor, you go to branch only for auditing. You are not permitted to go to data center. You are permitted to go to branch office. Then in branch level, they are giving, yes, they have to give user ID password to gain access to the production server, to gain access to the report server. And this is very invariably given. If not given in the engagement letter, you have to clearly put up and give it to them and see that it is. Branch level is risky because having downloaded from the data center report server, local man is always, not always, may be biased, there are chances of alteration. See, neutral level, data center level, different branches, the people do not bother there. What is properly to be generated and the information will be available. So it depends. That is why I told you already, you choose a 10 account, 5 accounts each in every category and go through base paper and verify all scheme, all the parameter table and satisfy yourself and no inconsistency. Then based on that, you conclude your report and document it. So working paper based on that, you can write.
Sir, two more minutes, sir.
Yes, I think I have given some insight into this area. It is a big area. We can go on for even 2-3 days. So such a lengthy. This I conclude. Thank you.
Wait for 2 minutes. An announcement from the chairman of SICASA, CA Jonal Kejar.
Thank you, Aloni. This is about the banqueting seminar for students we are organizing tomorrow. I hope most of you have received the SMS and the mass mails. And SICASA is this time working under the theme of Engage, Empower and Enable. And we have tomorrow from 10 to 4:30, we have the seminar for students. We have lined up very brilliant, eminent learned speakers. And today's chief guest, Mr. M. Narendra, has also kindly consented to be the chief guest tomorrow. A very short inaugural session, he has also promised to deliver an inspirational address. I'm sure that the students equipping better to do the audit will help discharge the audit much more easily and promptly. So I would very, very humbly request every one of you through your communication channel to inform your students to send them in large numbers so that they would get geared for this next bank audit season. And I assure you that with the kind of speakers we have, you'll have surely a lot of value addition and they will be better geared for doing the audit. I thank you in anticipation of a great response.
Tomorrow, Brahmaya.
Sorry, I'm sorry, at Brahmaya Hall, SIRC premises. Thank you very much for reminding us. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. May I now invite C.A. Deenadayal sir to kindly come over to the dais and hand over a memento on behalf of each and everyone present here to the speaker of the. In 45 minutes, we will have the third session started.
Is organizing a program, one day bank audit seminar for the students. I request all of you to send your article clerks so that they get equipped for the audit and for the field work which they are supposed to do in April. Friends, there are a lot of concerns about audit quality in bank audit. Last week I was with the chairman of one of the Kerala banks, where a lot of concerns have been raised on audit quality. The two concerns, one, two types of NPAs, they say, non-performing assets, and unfortunately to say, non-performing auditors as well. RBI has blacklisted, I understand, that 8 big firms in the last 4-5 months for quality reasons, and many of the auditors are being taken to task for hasty reporting without looking into the real details of an audit. On that note, though I am not here to do any sermon, my only request to you is not to be bound by the artificial timelines the bankers create for us. With due respect to any bankers, if they are there in our midst, They say that the audit has to be completed before 5th April. You start on 2nd April. And unfortunately, most of the bank managers welcome us with a question. When will you finish the audit? As you enter the bank. And therefore, this need not be considered too. We can take our own time. There's nothing which prevents us. There will be pressure from the RO. But we should take the normal time, take a team, and make sure that as what we do in any other statutory audit, the bank audit has to be done in strict compliance with what is required to be done. On that note, I'm reminding you about the latest guidance note on bank audit. The Auditing and Assurance Standards Board has come out with the latest version of the bank audit, and also the institute has got on its website the background material for bank audit covering all the aspects, including the tech aspects like sailing through the CBS environment effectively. And LFIR, they say that often LFIR is seen, particularly when we send the students and for the roundup only we go, LFIR is seen as a questionnaire where we just put yes, no and not applicable. And MOCs are rare, memorandum of changes are rare. Now, Vivek will surely enlighten us on the classification verification of advances, and Mr. Swaminathan is also there in the next session for income recognition and provisioning norms, the IRAC norms as they are called, prudential norms. So this is a backdrop in which we are discussing and deliberating on bank audit today. And we had a wonderful takeoff with the chairman, Mr. Narendra, giving us the expectations of a banker. Let me now move on to formally introducing the speaker, a very good dear friend of mine. We have worked together in Sikasa at Ernakulam in Cochin. We have worked together at the branch and has been a very good friend, been very supportive, and we work like brothers in arms. Vivek is not new to Chennai. I think for the last 2 years, he has been a very regular faculty. Last year for the bank audit, I distinctly remember he was there and also handled many study circle meetings in Chennai. He is the partner of Verma & Verma with more than 15 years of diversified practice experience to his credit, and is highly pedigreed. His lineage is, I'm sure many of us will not know that he is the second son of the legendary Venugopal C. Govind. And they qualified with the highest marks from Kerala and also qualified CISA, and he served as the chairman of the Ernakulam branch in 2010-11, during which the branch was adjudged the best All India Best Branch Award. And he is also one of the top 50 youth icons of Kerala by New Age, and is on this Kerala State Council of the CII for the year 13-14. Chairman of Finance and MSME Forums of Kerala Management Association, and is this year the president of Rotary Club of Downtown. I'm also an Rotary president this year for another club in Cochin. He has just finished a 15-day CSR fortnight, very effective, one of the best programs the district has seen this year. And he's also the vice president of the Kerala chapter of ISACA, and the chairman elect of Young Indians, a sister organization of CII for 13-14. He was chairman of the Ernakulam branch of Sikasa, incidentally, and also for 2 years, and both the years, he got the All India Best Student Branch Award to Cochin, which has now become 14 years. Cochin is continuing the same trend. He's also serving as treasurer of the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal Association, Cochin, serving as visiting faculty at many B schools in Cochin and Kerala, many places in Kerala, trustee of the CanCure Trust, district and state level tennis player. He was a sports enthusiast as well, and keenly interested in music, movies, books and cultural activities. Happily married to Durga, also a chartered accountant, and is blessed with a son. So this is the young and dynamic speaker for this afternoon. It is a very personal privilege and special situation for me. A task for me to introduce and welcome Vivek for the afternoon session, I think, which is the most important session for the old days deliberations, verification of advances, a practical perspective. Introducing Vivek Krishna Govind and inviting him to start the session. Thank you.
The session moderator and my very good friend, C.A. Jomon George, most distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for having me here this afternoon and for giving me this opportunity to share some of my experiences and some of my thoughts on a topic which is of great importance and relevance from the perspective of bank audit. Before I commence, let me just take a minute to, you know, it sounded coming from a very good friend, it was rather embarrassing to sit here and listen to so many things being said about me, but I take it with all humility, and it's a matter of great honor for me, because when my ICIA association or my institute association began when I was a student secretary of SICASA in 97, and it was a great privilege for me that the gentleman who was here was the chairman of SICASA at that point in time, and that he gave me this opportunity to get active in SICASA and in ICA activities, and thereafter over the last 15-16 years. Incidentally, he was also my senior in Varman Varma, though we've never worked together. He was in our Chennai office and I was in Cochin office all along. But in the last 15-16 years, we've associated at all levels in multiple organizations, because both of us are very active in terms of, he read out a few names of a few organizations. He's equally associated with all those organizations which he has read out, be it Rotary or be it the Kerala Management Association or any of these other forums which are there in our little hometown. And so it's a wonderful opportunity and an honor for me to be sharing space with you, sir. So without much ado, I will get started with my topic. I have about an hour to speak, so I'll try and keep it as crisp and as focused as possible. In case I'm going off tangent or in case somebody wants to interrupt me, please feel free to do so, because this has to be a two-way interaction and a knowledge transfer, because I'm way too junior in the system. I think I could be one amongst the youngest in this hall right now, so I don't deem myself to be an expert senior faculty who can be handling classes for such eminent senior professionals. But with my limited knowledge and experience, I have tried to do the level best that I can, and I hope I can live up to the great expectations which have been thrust upon me. So I'll move on. Now, why have I shown this slide as the introduction? I'll read out what I have written in this slide. Para 1.2 of Master Circular says, the policy of income recognition should be objective and based on record of recovery than on any subjective considerations. And Para 2.1.1 of the Master Circular says, an asset becomes non-performing when it ceases to generate income for the bank. Now, this is going to be the philosophy of my presentation here. I am not going to be talking about norms. There is a session which follows. I'm not questioning the norms. I'm not saying that norms are not important. But let me put it this way, it's not just about the norms. Norms are important, but let us not use the norms, or let us not utilize loopholes in the norms to not classify an asset which is not performing. This is the backdrop, or this is the philosophy with which I would like to speak, and as my session topic is a practical perspective on verification of advances, I will try and share certain practical experiences that we have had during the course of our both branch as well as central audits. Even at the central audits, I will speak only from the perspective of advances which could have been done or which could be done at a branch level, but which probably was sometimes missed by the branch auditors and found. I see my good friend from PricePath sitting here. We've had a wonderful four-year association in a very leading bank in Kerala, and it was so much of fun and energy for us quarter on quarter to come up with and to find and unearth all kinds of advances and issues which would many of which or most of which have resulted in substantial NPAs in that particular bank. So this is going to be the philosophy. I know that the circular has several clauses which talk about the importance of norms. So I don't really want to get into an intellectual debate here as to are norms more important or is it the health of the account which is more important. I'm not on a debate here. So let my hands are up when it comes to that. But I would like to restrict my conversation to this particular thought process as to the way we see it, the health of the account is definitely more important than the norms. You can use the norms if it is a case which is a borderline case and where you actually want to argue it out and where you're trying to do it can swing both ways if it is a situation, then you can go to the norms. But otherwise, if inherently an account is bad or inherently an account is weak or inherently an account is unhealthy, let us not use the norms technically because a credit has come in or because the 90 days is on the 89th day something has come and that got reversed, that does not really get into the every comma and semicolon in the norms to try and help the bank. We need not do that. We really don't need to do that. If we try to do that, we may tomorrow land up in a United Bank situation. I don't know if somebody else has spoken about it, or if not, probably somebody else will during the course. I'm not going to get into the United Bank situation. But then another external auditor comes in and finds that the NPA is three times what has been disclosed. Can be extremely embarrassing and can be extremely, you know, can show all of our professional skills as mere negligence if we are to audit like that, you know. So let's first understand, let's go with the whole substance over form philosophy, and that's why I thought I'll just spend 5 minutes to try and emphasize that that is how I have structured this presentation and the examples which follow. Now these are the heads which I will be covering during the course of this discussion. Quality of appraisal, health of accounts, greening, evergreening, drawing power related issues, agricultural advances, pre-shipment and post-shipment, restructured advances, large projects, bridges, roads, etc., which are under implementation, and certain concerns related to the health of the accounts, concerns related to transparency, concerns related to trust, etc., I will discuss. And then there are a few slides related to issues related to advances. I'm not too sure if I can, whether I will have the time. If I do, I will try and get into a few of those. If not, those are rather self-explanatory, and I think the slides, the presentation has already been circulated to you. So if it's possible, I'll try and cover that. If not, I'll be happy if I can cover till the concerns and control within the next 1 hour. The quality of appraisal, so that's where it begins. So let me start at the very beginning, you know. Where does this whole cycle of NPA begin? It doesn't begin after an account has turned bad. So as an auditor, where do we start? Where does our work really start? Does it really start only by looking at Finacle or Marvel or whatever else is the software used by the bank? We look at it and we look at it vis-a-vis the IRAC and say, well, fine, everything is okay. I've looked at all major accounts exceeding 1 crore or 50 lakhs, whatever it is here. You know, materiality threshold, depending on the size of the branch, you will fix. And then you say, we've checked everything, fine. Your senior student or your audit manager goes and gives you a confirmation saying that we've checked everything with the system and norms are complied. Does our job end there? Definitely not. We need to understand, we need to at least, I'm not really saying that, you know, we need to do 100% verification of everything, etc. That's not what I'm trying to say. But for large cases, now if you look at our seminar is on bank branch audits. So we must understand that any branch audit that we do, there will always be 3 or 4 or 5 maybe large advances in any branch. There could be 5, 10, unless it's a corporate branch or something, where there could be more. There we will need a different strategy altogether, more people and more time and etc., and which is generally given by the banks. For doing corporate banking branches and all that, no banker or nobody puts pressure on you to finish it in 5 days, 6 days and all that. You are always told you are given 15, 20 days to do such branches. But normally, typically when we go for a branch, we have about 5 days or 6 days as is informed to us. Please do not go there with that preconceived notion, booking your return tickets back, that I'm coming back in 4 days time, or your team is saying that you go on 2nd and 6th you book back and all that. Don't do that. Go there, understand, assess. Sometimes it may be over in 3 days, but sometimes it may take 8 days, 10 days. Nobody really minds. These managers may be putting pressure on you, but trust me, no bank at the top management level is actually putting pressure. We've sat on both sides, both on the as a branch auditor as well as a central auditor, and we know this. These branch audit reports are sent to the central auditor on 6th or 7th, and the central auditor actually starts reviewing it on 25th or 26th. So why do you want to, you know, send it 2 weeks or 3 weeks before he starts looking at it? Have a word with the central auditor if you see that there is a problem, or if it's taking more time, have a word with the central auditor and he will talk to the top management and ensure that the you know, respective branch manager is given instructions to, you know, give you more time. So many cases where that has happened, where, you know, several branch auditors have spoken to some of us and said that why don't you just talk to them, find out from the GM and all that, and then every single case in every single bank, trust me, Once you talk to the, once you have a direct connect with the top management, you will see that this 4-day, 5-day pressure is immediately gone. There is no such pressure. It's just created by the branches so that, you know, you can be out before, you know, at the earliest, you know. And no offense meant to the branch officials, some of whom may be present here, but I think that's the way it is. I think that's acknowledged the reality here. Now, from an appraisal perspective, what is it that we need to do? These are the headings. I will bring a few examples as I move forward. The identification of risk, quick mortality, whether that is happening in that branch, whether restructuring, whether in that branch. Understand from an overall macro perspective. A senior person or a chartered accountant or one of us, if we are going there, all of this can be understood in about an hour or two by looking at it, by discussing with them, picking up a file or two, just to understand how does it work in this particular branch or the bank itself. Whether CIBIL is being used, enhancement of facility, etc. Understand the quality of appraisal. This is just an illustrative list here. Now I'll just talk about a couple of examples of poor appraisal or deficiencies in appraisal which can affect us. Now, in a particular bank which was in Kerala, every single example which I'm quoting here are factually correct. And since you know, we have some of our joint auditors from some of my other banks which we have done, some of them are here. Sometimes when you see the example, I'm sure you know, it'll ring a bell. You will even know which case I'm talking about. I'm not bringing any names here for confidentiality reasons, obviously. Now, this is a situation where the real estate sector was under considerable stress. This company was already being reported in the media of defaulting in completion, and there were enough complaints against them. They had multiple projects going on. There were serious viability issues. It was very clear to one and all that there was long-term fund, short-term diversion and rolling and all of that happening. And yet, the bank goes ahead and gives them loans for two projects. Not for the company as a whole or for all projects as well. Two new projects with a very nice detailed project report and viability study. If you see only those two projects, it's all very foolproof, very well done by the consultant, and the bank goes ahead and gives loan. Is that acceptable? At that point when we are auditing, it had not turned NPA when we saw this first. But do we still not have a responsibility to report? And your session on LFAR, I think, is over. But still, let me add a line on that. Is it not important for us to report on it nevertheless? It's not just about, you know, converting standard accounts into NPA. That's not the only job for us. It's equally important that we bring to the attention of the management that there are stressed accounts, that there are probable NPA accounts, there are accounts which need to be watchlisted and followed up. Otherwise, these are going down the drain. That is also very much an inherent responsibility of each one of us. So we need to bring that to the attention of the board. Once it becomes an NPA and you've done the audit, just 3 months back you've done the audit and you have not brought it up before the management, 3 months later you bring it up and you know, the reasons were very obvious, then the management will wonder, as auditors, what have you been doing? You haven't told us. You haven't informed us. You did the audit. You were there. You've done a very detailed assignment here. You have not brought it to our attention. They can point fingers at us, and increasingly life for all of us is getting to be miserable. I think we all know that. 5 years ago, we had a lot more respect in society and in industry and all of that. Today, we are being perceived with a certain microscopic perspective through which, you know, at least for a few years, the struggle is going to be there for us to ensure that the whole professional image is back on track. So, few years, and now with this whole Companies Act coming in the way it is, and NFRA and whatnot, you know, we really don't know. There's going to be so much of surveillance on all of us as we move forward. So, that has to be seen. When we sit across the table with the top management of the bank, what do they tell us? They tell us that we don't want branch audits. It's serving no purpose for us. Branch audit itself needs to be disbanded. You forget 20 crore or 6 crore or 50 crore. We don't need branch audits. Let us have a more effective central audit or an effective regional level audit. Let us not have branch audits is what they say, because that is the way they are looking at the profession. So for us to ensure that our professional image is intact, and for us to ensure that we still continue to have the respect which we did, we may need to do a little more, which is why, you know, some of these examples which I'm telling you, again, you know, another couple of minutes. Why I'm spending is because I want the whole philosophy of this conversation to be taken in the right perspective. Otherwise, many of you here will think, what can we do with 3 days if you start looking at appraisal? Who has the time? Who will do it? Who gives us the fee? That day, those days are gone. Those days are passe, where we think that fee is only 10,000, so I will do only work for 10,000. We can't do that anymore. We'll have to do everything that we need to do. We can, of course, go and try and talk to them and get an increased fee for it if it is possible. But if it's not possible, we'll still have to do what needs to be done. That's the unfortunate scenario we are in today. So this is a classic case of a deficiency in appraisal. This is another case which we saw. Now, CIBIL, everybody knows about CIBIL. Before any major account is disbursed or sanctioned, you need to check the credibility of these people. Virtually everybody is being tracked on CIBIL. You are tracked, I am tracked based on our home loan repayment or our credit card, the way we are in terms of payment, etc. Everything is being tracked by CIBIL. So when there are CIBIL reports available for all the large industries, etc., or for the companies, virtually any individual, there is a CIBIL report. How is it? It's absolutely impossible to believe that they have not looked at CIBIL, but that is what has happened. Absolutely adverse remarks in CIBIL. This is a classic case which happened in one of the largest branches in Bombay, where we saw that it was complete fraud. The entire thing, it was for some kind of a loan which was given to multiple people, based on which it was consolidated into one company, and the loan was given for smaller agricultural advances, because this was an agricultural produce company, and it was in the name of these smaller borrowers. And every paper you look at, you'll see that there will be an 80-year-old man, which was age 26 on his PAN card. There will be a photograph of a lady with the name of a man and with M, etc., election card. These are the idea. I mean, in about 10 minutes flat, if you really look into the whole process, you know that this is a major fraud. This was a major fraud, a reported fraud, and about bank lost about 50-60 crores on account of just one account, which could very easily have been avoided. Thereafter, you can take action against the manager and all of that. Things can happen, but end of the day, it has slipped at all levels. An account of that magnitude, which actually had a board approval for it, none of these things had actually come up, till the account turned bad. So do we have a responsibility? Certainly we do. This was an account which was found during the course of branch audit when we were there as auditors. This is not pointed out at any other stage. It's not that the account had turned bad either. When we pointed this out, then it was taken up, and then they put an investigative agency to it, and then the facts came out. Now moving on to the health of the account, these are some of the topics I'll cover. The operation, stress testing, greening, etc., will only postpone. So these are the fundamentals that we need to, the philosophy which we must keep in mind when we look at the health of an account. Now in the next few slides, I'll talk about a few cases or the perspective with which we need to look, so that such cases which I'm showing here can be found out by us. In this particular case, ABC Limited enjoyed an OD facility and a term loan facility. The party consistently remits the interest at the end of each quarter only to regularize the account. These credits were immediately withdrawn by overdrawing the CC limit after the quarter end. Very simple. Very simple. If you look at it technically, if a junior person looks at it, or somebody who goes about it with a very mundane mindset of just looking at it vis-a-vis the norms, it's all fine. On the 88th day, the money has come in, and it's been taken out only on the 95th day. Is it an NPA? Is it an NPA? What do you think? Can I get some answer? Definitely yes, right? So, but now we have that responsibility, which means to say that we need to take a look. It doesn't end. 31st March is the year end. We can't stop with 31st March. We need to look at it till April 5th or April 6th or till whatever time it is that we are at the branch. We need to look at the subsequent period also. It's a very simple case. Couple of cases I'll tell you where a little bit of intelligent thinking has gone in. This is another case where the statement of account shows credits and immediate debits and virtually no operation. Now, virtually no operation itself is something that we need to take a look at. One credit or one debit comes in, and there are two credits, or two debits comes in and there is one credit. The account statement. Account, yes. You have something to say, sir? I'm sorry, I can't hear you, sir.
Sir, can we defer questions to the, and we'll have a floor participation for 10 minutes after the session is over.
Okay, sir.
Is it okay with you, sir?
Now, this is another simple case where you will see, you go through the file, and please do not restrict yourself. I'm again telling you very clearly, I'm not saying that this kind of an activity can be done for all accounts. It's impossible. But look at the A category accounts in the branch, above 1 crore, above 50 lakhs, above 25 lakhs, above 5 crores. Depending on the size of the branch, the top 5 or top 10 accounts, we must go threadbare into it. Unless it's a government-backed account or something. But otherwise, we need to really go into it and understand. And then when you look at it, you see simple thing. You go through the file, go through the correspondence file, and you see that there are 10 letters saying that you have not paid the money. If you know the account is unhealthy. I'm not saying that you need to classify it as an NPA because there are reminder letters. That's not what I'm trying to say. But then it gives you an indication that this is an unhealthy account. So you need to do some extra procedures to it to ensure and to understand whether something has been done fraudulently or with an ill intent to keep this afloat as a performing asset. This is a very simple case. Another case, it was learned that the party faces a possible substantial loss. This is a case where when you go through the correspondence file, you will see that. You are seeing that in March, that you know there are some problems, or let us say something like the National Spot Exchange, which has now crashed. We all know that the Spot Exchange has crashed. Spot Exchange crashes on, say, July 20 or 25th or 24th. We are doing the June quarter audit, and we are there, before our audit is over, we have clear information. Should we not consider the subsequent events? We know that the exchange is gone. We know that the exchange has to stop. And now you are a bank which has financed the spot exchange. Should you not take that subsequent? Technically, as of June 30th, it is an excellent performing asset. But does that mean that if you are signing your interim financials on, say, August 5th or 6th, can you say it is a performing asset? Definitely no. You must at least give